Welcome to the Berean Bible class of Elkview Baptist Church. Thank you for joining us for the study. We've been working our way through the book of Matthew, and we've made it up to chapter 9, and we're going to look at an interesting account of where Jesus healed a crippled person, and it was quite an amazing event. So as we begin, I would like to first just read a few verses, and then we'll talk about them. And by way of just a little bit more background, these verses we're about to read mention faith. And in this particular account, it describes just their faith. It doesn't have an adjective in front of it as far as like it does in other verses. Like in some places, Jesus calls people's faith great faith, and in other places, little faith. And often it's the Gentiles he uses the adjective great faith, and his own disciples little faith. So just an interesting observation there about how Jesus describes people's faith. So with that, let's read a few verses from Matthew chapter 9, beginning with verse number 1. It says, "So he got into a boat, crossed over, and came to his own city. Then behold, they brought to him a paralytic lying on a bed. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, 'Son, be of good cheer. Your sins are forgiven you.'" Then verse 3, "And at once some of the scribes said within themselves, 'This man blasphemes.' But Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, 'Why do you think evil in your hearts? For which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, arise and walk?'" Then verse 6, "But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. Then he said to the paralytic, 'Arise, take up your bed, and go to your house.' And he arose and departed to his house." And then verse 8, "Now when the multitudes saw it, they marveled and glorified God who had given such power to men." And you'll notice there in verse 8 the word multitudes, because when the account of Matthew is given, it isn't perfectly clear how big the crowd is, but there is a really big crowd here. So let's take our time now and back up and talk about each of these verses in Matthew chapter 9, 1 through 8. And beginning there with verse number 1, there's a description that apparently Jesus was on a boat ride. And following the account through the book of Matthew, we know that he left a particular city named Capernaum, and then now he's really coming back. But the city that he's in is really clear because the parallel gospels in Mark show that it was Capernaum. In fact, one of the handouts that you'll see with the lesson when you look at it online is I posted a PDF file with the parallel passages from the book of Mark and the book of Luke. And I really like to do that because when you look at all the scriptures together about this specific account, you learn more information and details about what happened. And in fact, on this particular slide, you notice that I had who was present at this event. And of course, the Pharisees and teachers of the law were there from Luke 5:17. The scribes were described there in Matthew 9:3. There was a large crowd, according to Mark 2:4. And then, of course, we know from the previous verses in Matthew 8 that the disciples were present. But let me just take a second and read from the PDF file that would also be available on the handouts. From Mark 2, chapter 2, verse 2, it says, "Immediately many gathered together so that there was no longer room to receive them, not even near the door, and he preached the word to them." So that just gives you a little bit more description of how big the crowd was around this house. And then also from Luke 5:17, a little bit more information about what was going on. It says, "Now it happened on a certain day, as he was teaching, that there were Pharisees and teachers of the law sitting by, who had come out of every town of Galilee, Judea, and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was present to heal them. So with that little bit of extra description added to Matthew chapter 9, verse 1, you see that it was a big crowd, and you see that they came from all over the land to come and hear Jesus teach. So pretty interesting, and that's why we know where it was, Capernaum, and we know who all was present in terms of the Pharisees, the teachers of the law, the scribes, a multitude or a crowd, and the disciples. So we think about Capernaum. The next slide shows a little bit of a picture of more present-day Capernaum. It looks like a really beautiful place, and the body of water there is the Sea of Galilee, and this would be on the northwest corner of the Sea of Galilee. And from the account that Jesus is given here in Matthew and the other Gospels, before this he left Capernaum and went to the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee, and now in Matthew chapter 9, verse 1, he's now coming back to Capernaum. And then the next slide, we have a little map of the area in Israel here, but you can see, you know, Jerusalem's way down there to the south, Capernaum's up there to the northwest of the Sea of Galilee. So you can see that there was a wide area where people were coming from, and thus the description that there was a great multitude or a crowd there. So let's think a little bit more now about verse number 2. It says, "Then behold, they brought to him a paralytic lying on a bed. And then when Jesus saw their faith." So let's think for just a little bit about those who are bringing the paralytic to Jesus. First, I would think they're either friends or family, somebody who was pretty concerned about him. And we also know that from Mark 2:3 that there were four of them at least that were carrying him. Could there have been others with him? Possibly. But it says four of his friends carried him. And Jesus notices their faith. And let's think just a little bit more about this event where they're bringing the paralytic to Jesus. We already know now that it's a large crowd, and it's such a large crowd, they can't even get near the door of the house. And from Luke 5:19, let me read this particular verse on the slide. It says, "And when they could not find how they might bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the housetop and let him down with his bed through the tiling or roof." So it's obvious these guys were determined, and the crowd wasn't going to stop them. They were motivated. And then let's read also from Mark chapter 2, verse 4. It also says, "And when they could not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where he was. So when they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying." What determination of friends to take a roof off of a house, to go around the crowd, and make their way into getting this needy person in front of Jesus. So really an amazing effort on the part of his friends. And that's why I think Jesus marveled and recognized their faith. So let's think a little bit more about these friends that Jesus says he saw their faith. Because I would observe here that when they were making this great effort, that obviously they cared. Their love for their friend moved them. They had faith. With faith, their faith was based in hope because they believed Jesus could heal them. And then they acted. They didn't just believe and have faith. They acted on their faith. They were motivated to help their friend. And then it's also interesting that they didn't let anything stop them in getting their friend to Jesus. Getting him up on the roof, what an effort. Tearing the roof apart, what an effort. And then lowering him into the room where Jesus was teaching. Wow, what an effort they made. So really just amazing here how the faith of these friends moved them to help the person in need. So, and then thinking about the next slide here, the paralytic himself, you know, obviously, if you're crippled or paralyzed, you're unable to help yourself. He was helpless. And it's also clear he was a sinner because Christ forgives his sins. And we could ask the question, was the man's physical condition the result of sin? In this case, we wouldn't know, but I'll share a little bit more with that in a moment. But here, Jesus takes care of the main problem first, the forgiveness that was needed. So here is another slide where we're thinking about the paralytic and what the Jews assumed. They thought that sickness was a result of sin. And you can even go back into the Old Testament and think about Job's friends. Job's friends said, Job, curse God and die, or confess your sins and die, because they believed that the sickness was related to his calamity. But Jesus rejected the Jews' assumption that sickness was a result of sin. It could just be sickness. And in John chapter 9, verse 1 to 3, Christ specifically calls them out on that because he says a blind man's sin wasn't necessarily the result of, a blind man's affliction was not necessarily the result of sin. So, another good point there. Then in verse 2, a really amazing statement by Jesus, at least in the eyes of all present, because he says, Son, be of good cheer, your sins are forgiven you. And so we could ask the question, well, why did Jesus come? He came to be a sacrifice for sins. And there's other examples in Scripture where Christ forgave sin. And even in Isaiah, he says in chapter 43, verse 25, I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and I will not remember your sins. So Jesus wants to be able to forgive us of our sins. However, it's clear from verse 3 in chapter 9 that the scribes were thinking in their heart, this man blasphemes. So why were they so upset? Because they knew something. The scribes knew that only God can forgive sins. In fact, in Mark 2:7, it says, who can forgive sins but God alone? And on this particular point, the scribes and the Pharisees and the teachers of the law got it right. Only God can forgive sins. So here we have Jesus forgiving sins. And thus, you would conclude, Jesus is God. So that's why they were upset. They weren't necessarily upset that he healed the guy in this particular case, but that he said something here that only God can do. And here's a really big exclamation point that Jesus is God. He is deity. And then we know that the scribes, yes, they were knowledgeable people. They were teachers of the law. They were qualified to teach in the synagogues. So they knew the real heart of the issue here, Christ forgiving sins. We'll see in a moment, though, he used even a title that's a messianic title. And then verse number 4, it says, but Jesus knowing their thoughts. So I've got a little picture there, a penny for your thoughts, but here's the case where Christ knew their thoughts. And of course, accusing Jesus of blaspheming would be evil. Then on verse number 5, it says, for which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, arise and walk? And here, I would make the observation that the act of forgiveness would not be clearly observable by those present. Meaning Jesus could say, your sins are forgiven you, and they wouldn't know for sure if he was forgiven. But Jesus puts an exclamation point on this by the healing, because the healing is clearly visible to them all. And that's where we get into and move on to verse number 6, where it says, but that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, "Arise, take up your bed, and go to your house." So this power to forgive is proven by his power to heal. A great miracle of healing that amazed all of them. And wow, they were in amazement. The power to forgive, evidenced by the power to heal in that moment. And then in those phrases Jesus used, he said, "Son of Man." And that's a messianic title. The scribes, the Pharisees, and the teachers of the law should have recognized that when Jesus referred to himself as the Son of Man. And by the way, that's in all three of the Synoptic Gospels here with Matthew, Mark, and Luke. He uses that same title. But in Matthew, it's really emphasized roughly 29 times the Son of Man, the messianic title, was used. And that even comes back from the Old Testament. I have a reference on that slide to Daniel chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, where it says, "And behold, one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven." So the scribes and Pharisees and teachers of the law, they knew what that title meant, and they understood that Jesus forgave sins. So as we wrap up this lesson, because of these truths, when we think back and see the faith of those friends and what moved them, it should encourage us to live a life of faith. And not only that, it should encourage us to act on our faith. And then, just like in this account of Jesus healing this paralytic, wouldn't it be great if he noticed our faith? So with those things, let's close with a word of prayer. But thanks again for joining in the study. It's been a privilege sharing the word with you. So let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your great love. We thank you for your word, that we can look into it and we can see these amazing things that you've done, that you are the Messiah, that you are the Son of Man, that you are our Lord and Savior. Thank you again for the privilege of sharing your word. In Jesus' name we pray, and amen.